नमस्ते। इन दिस 179th वेबिनार बाय फवाई फोरम वी आर गोइंग टू टेक ए लुक एट एन एंटायरली डिफरेंट टॉपिक इन अ सेंस दो इन अनदर सेंस दिस टॉपिक हैज क्वाइट अ लॉट इन कॉमन विद वेदांत दर्शन ग्लिम्सेस ऑफ सांख्य दर्शन इज अवर थीम। सांख्य इज वन ऑफ द सिक्स आस्तिक दर्शनस। बाय आस्तिक वी मीन दोस हु एक्सेप्ट द अथॉरिटी ऑफ द वेदास। इन एडिशन एट सम प्लेसेस Astika can mean those who accept the existence of God. Here, the six schools of thought, Astika Darshanas, are called so based on the first criterion. For, as I shall make it clear in a while, this very Darshana school of thought, Sankhya, does not accept at least explicitly God or Ishvara at all. Purva Mimamsa also doesn't give any importance to Ishvara. Therefore, we have of these six schools, Sankhya and Purva Mimamsa not accepting God, but then why do we call all these six as Astika Darshanas? All these six, namely Nyaya and Vaisheshika, two, Sankhya and Yoga, four, Purva Mimamsa and Uttara Mimamsa. Uttara Mimamsa itself is popularly known as Vedanta. Why do we call them Astika Darshanas? Because these six accept the authority of the Vedas. They would never say something which will be at variance with what the Vedas have said according to them. It is their interpretation of the Vedas. All right. The importance of Sankhya Darshana is that it is Sankhya which has supplied a number of philosophical tools, philosophical concepts, a number of constructs, a number of theoretical positions which have been literally, bodily lifted and integrated into other schools. For example, among the six, Yoga, which is the fourth school, as we said, Nyaya, Vaisheshika, Sankhya and Yoga. Yoga is 90% Sankhya only. Then of course, Yoga has added a number of other principles. As you know, Patanjali's Yoga has the Ashta Anga. So why did I say 90%? I must hasten to add, as far as the theoretical foundation of Yoga school of thought is concerned, it is 90% Sankhya. As far as practices, codes of conduct, and the famous 10 commandments, as they call them, Yama and Niyama, five each, of Yoga Shastra, have been called by scholars the 10 commandments of Hinduism, or at least of Yoga Shastra. So those are added. They are not from Sankhya, but the theoretical basis. All right. Since Sankhya provides the foundation for other schools of thought, it has been valued a lot. However, as we are meeting in this 21st century, we must look around and see how many people are followers of Sankhya Darshana. Very few. There are a few here and there, but Sankhya Darshana has taken a back seat now but it is respected and it is studied by a lot of people, for concepts become very clear, which then help them in the study of Uttaramimamsa especially. So the fame of or the great name of Sankhya has to be appreciated, that as we put it in the synopsis also that went to all of you in the invitation to the webinar, in the Mahabharata itself, in the 12th Parva, it is said, Nasti Sankhya Samam Jnanam. There is no knowledge as superior as Sankhya. A tribute is paid. And Nasti Yoga Samam Balam. Those of us who can practice Yoga Shastra and go for all those sadhanas get a great bala, an inner strength. That, of course, is highly appreciated by modern times. All right. I must add here that while the founder of Sankhya Darshana is somebody called Kapila Muni, who is not the same as the incarnation of Mahavishnu, the name Kapila in the Bhagavatam. Kapila Muni of Bhagavatam, who gives a great teaching to his own mother, Devahuti, in the Bhagavatam, is different, and what he speaks over there is Uttaramimamsa Vedanta. But there was another Kapila Muni, probably several centuries before Christ, who had outlined this entire Sankhya philosophy. However, his own works somehow were not made available to people later on. They somehow got lost, or they went to a little background. It was in the 5th century AD, at the same time as historians would say, Kalidasa lived, that there is a certain person, a certain great scholar called Ishvara Krishna, wrote, you would be amused to know, just 70 shlokas, 70, saptati. And these 70 were known and are known as Sankhya Karikas. I'm carrying a Hindi book here, Sankhya Tattva Manorama. This gives, in fact, all the 70 Karikas and gives translation and Hindi explanation too. So, these 70 Sankhya Karikas became so well received that it even went to China in those days. First of all, these 70 stanzas are not only called Sankhya Karika, they are also called Sankhya Saptati. Saptati is 70. And they have been described as the pearl of the whole scholastic literature of India. So it has inspired a lot of people so much. And sometime, maybe in the 6th century, it is said, somebody called Paramartha, a scholar, maybe a sadhu called Paramartha, it is said a Brahmin from Ujjain, today in Madhya Pradesh, he went to China and he learned Chinese. And for the benefit of Chinese people, he translated the Sankhya Karikas, and they were known in Chinese. When you translate it into English, the title becomes The Golden 70 Discourse. The Golden 70 Discourse. How interesting it is that the Sankhya Karikas, just 70 of them, not in Anushtup, they are in a meter called Arya Giti, and they have done a splendid job. And as a result, so many works have come later on the Sankhya Karikas, all studying the Sankhya philosophy. Now, at the outset itself, to make matters easier for most of you who are Vedanta students, especially Advaita Vedanta students, I would like to mention four differences between Sankhya Darshana and Advaita Vedanta. Common features are in hundreds. So many of theoretical building blocks are the same. It is therefore believed that Sri Krishna of Bhagavad Gita and even our Adi various schools of thought have all taken, as I will throw more vision, it's very important that mass. Sankhya calls them not Atmas but Purushas. There is Purusha, there is Prakriti. Purusha is sentient, Prakriti is insentient, inert. Now the difference is Sankhya says Purushas are countless. And some of them get liberated, others are still hanging around. Their time also will come, they too will get liberated. So countless Purushas, and first we may visualize as though they are some tiny sparks or some such thing. You know, they are all there in every one of us. So the Atma Tattva called Purusha. But Sankhya Darshana says, this Purusha Tattva, though they are countless, are everywhere, they are omnipotent, they are omniscient, and so on. So it's interesting that Purushas are called numerous here. Purusha is changeless, eternal, and omnipresent everywhere. They are everywhere. Whereas Advaita Vedanta, as every one of you knows, uncompromisingly says Purusha is one. The plurality, like all of us feel we are many. In fact, we look at each other materially and even spiritually. We have a notion that somebody is advanced, somebody is behind. Philosophically, there are no such souls that are ahead and souls that are behind. There is only one soul, and that is Nitya Mukta. And this apparent many souls are called empirical souls. Empirical means they come across as being around there. If you scratch the surface, as Maharshi Ramana would say, if you conduct self-inquiry, you will find there are no pluralistic souls. There is no nanatva. Kathopanishad says, neha nana asti kinchana. Right? So, one Purusha in Advaita Vedanta and countless Purushas in Sankhya Darshana. Secondly, one reality is Advaita Darshana's stand. Jiva, Jagat, Ishvara, all of them are actually one only, appearing as many. Sankhya, not only with regard to Purushas, but to the whole scenario also, uncompromisingly maintains the position that there are many Purushas on one hand, and in addition, Prakriti is separately there. Prakriti is also called Pradhana. We will use the word Prakriti more often, but that is called Pradhana also. In fact, Dha means to keep. And Pradhana, when Prakriti appears in various ways, it is as though it is presented, it is placed before all of us in a majestic manner. So Pradhana. Pradhana, Alpa Prana is giving, but this is Pradhana. All right, Prakriti called Pradhana continues to exist. So, Prakriti and Purusha, there are two. And then Purusha is countless in that category. They will never merge. They will never become one, or they will never be discovered as one. And thirdly, talking of Sankhya alone, not combining it with yoga, you may ask, why should we combine it with yoga? I must clarify. Generally, Sankhya and yoga are studied together because, as I already said, yoga takes Sankhya as its theoretical basis, just adds one or two extra features, and for the practical sadhana, yoga has contributed a whole lot of practice. Sankhya specifically, no Ishvara. Only Purushas. All have certain fine qualities. That's a different story. Therefore, it's different from Advaita. Yoga, however, is plus Ishvara. Therefore, scholars often say Sankhya plus Ishvara is yoga as far as the theoretical foundation is concerned, or yoga minus is Sankhya. Or to put it in a Sanskrit compound form, yoga is Seshvara Sankhya, Sa plus Ishvara. Or Sankhya is Nirishvara Yoga, that is yoga minus Ishvara. And fourth and last main difference before we plunge into more details of Sankhya is, in the Sankhya, it is said, Purusha is not a karta, he is only bhokta. Purusha is bhokta. And Advaita Vedanta, which you have studied more, or most of you here, says Purusha in reality is neither karta nor bhokta. But I will point out a shloka in the Bhagavad Gita later, where Sri Krishna, not from the highest point of view, but talking on an intermediate level, says, Prakriti creates everything, and Bhoktratve Purushaha, Purushaha Bhoktratve Karanam Uchyate. There is a shloka. Let me read now itself. 20th verse of chapter 13 says, Karyakarana Kartratve Hetuhu Prakriti Ruchyate Purushaha Sukadukhanam Bhoktratve Hetu Ruchyate. Now that is an intermediate level. On a higher level, or the highest level, Advaita Vedanta says, Purusha, the one non-dual Atma, is neither Karta nor Bhokta. Sankhya doesn't budge. Sankhya says, Purusha is a Bhokta. Purusha is Bhokta, and then of course, when he gets liberated, he is freed from all sorrow. So these are the four differences between Sankhya and Vedanta Darshana. All right. You have already noted that in comparison with Advaita Vedanta, which is Advaita, non-dual, Sankhya is dualistic. Though it talks about Purushas one by one getting liberated and they are free forever, for good, never to return to samsara, but the total scenario continues to be dualistic. There is Prakriti with Sattva, Rajas and Tamas, and then there are countless Purushas. Now you may wonder, in between let me make a remark, was this webinar necessary? We are Vedanta students, and let us just know Vedanta. Why should we learn all this? You know, whenever you want to study something, it's always very helpful, very valuable to study some allied topics. You want to study India, it's better you study Bangladesh, Pakistan, and neighboring countries too. You want to study United States, it's good to know a little bit about Canada, about Mexico, and other, you know, business partners, allies, critics, and so on. Otherwise, your knowledge of United States is inadequate. So in order to get a deeper, you know, understanding, a better grip of Advaita Vedanta, it is very valuable, not only for teachers, but for students also, to have some understanding of Sankhya. In Jnana Yoga, I sometimes say, teachers need to learn a lot because they have to give lectures. But I want to add, students also should not be averse to study. They should also be open so that they can dive deeper in Jnana Yoga. To say, we don't want more details, give us the basics and then we will just dwell on it, would border a little on some kind of tamas, especially if you profess to be on Jnana Yoga. If you say, I am a bhakta and Vedanta for me is just an extra nourishment, then it's a different matter. But if you say, I am a student of Vedanta, I love to study and reflect on Vedanta. More than bhakti or yoga, karma or anything else, my passion is Vedanta. If you are saying that, you better learn some of the allied subjects to the right extent. Nobody is saying go and get caught in lots of concepts over there. So you have Sankhya being a dualistic philosophy. All right. So here we have, on and off I'll make references to yoga, because yoga, that is the fourth darshana among the six, is closely connected to Sankhya once more in its theoretical foundation. What are the special contributions of Sankhya, or as we stand in 2020 AD, what is it that we especially should appreciate in the Sankhya Darshana? Other day, what prompted me to offer this webinar also was that a week ago, Dr. Kushal Shah, a professor of electrical engineering in ISER, Indian Institute of Science Education and Research in Bhopal, and I, Dr. Shah and I, had an interaction on Sankhya and modern science. So we were trying to dig into whether there are some parallels, and not much, but one or two surely can be found. Professor Hiriyanna, whose book on Indian philosophy is an all-time classic, Professor Hiriyanna, Outlines of Indian Philosophy, M. Hiriyanna, right? He was a professor in University of Mysore, and for some years, he was actually together with Dr. S. Radhakrishnan. If I remember right, Radhakrishnan was a few years junior. Professor Hiriyanna perhaps was senior. While Hiriyanna continued in the University of Mysore, Radhakrishnan changed, moved over to other universities, I think went to Kolkata and so on, became vice president. Then, as all of you know, became the president of India. Professor Hiriyanna, in a book that he wrote in the middle of last century itself, says, just as Newton's first law talks about inertia, that which is moving keeps moving unless an external force is brought into the scenario. That which is stationary remains stationary unless an external force is brought into the picture. Now, Sankhya talked about a certain principle of perpetual motion of prakriti. Prakriti is constantly evolving, changing, moving. No one can stop it. And that has a semblance, resemblance with Newton's first law. But then a doubt is raised. Professor Hiriyanna himself mentions, what about pralaya? There is a state of pralaya where entire prakriti gets dissolved and sattva, rajas and tamas are in samya, in equilibrium. And it appears that nothing is now moving. So how did movement end and stationary state come about? And then later on, when pralaya duration is over, what makes it again get into movement? Movement to being stationary to movement, what is the? And it is said in Sankhya that that change is brought about by the sannidhya of Purusha. Purusha is sentient, and Purusha makes Prakriti move, makes Prakriti stop, and so on. And as you know well, elsewhere, especially in some bhakti-oriented literature, we talk about Shiva as being without any movement, Shakti, Mother Parvati, being full of movement. But it is Shiva who prompts Parvati in the subtlest way, without raising a finger, to move and to do everything. All right. So we have another point. Nothing is destroyed. In Sankhya, these principles were mentioned some thousands of years ago. Nothing is destroyed. Everything only changes its form. So there is no creation. There's a Sanskrit word for it, arambha. Certain schools of thought which say that things come out from nowhere, things are created, they belong to the camp called arambhavada. Whereas here it is only abhivyakti. It is only coming into expression. Nothing is newly created. Nothing is destroyed. Things come into expression. Things go back to a state of unmanifest condition. And it is also a bit scientific and fascinating from science point of view that in those good old times, the Sankhya philosophy talked about three constituents, sattva, rajas, and tamas. And three is the minimum to bring about various combinations. As you know, Bhagavad Gita dedicates a whole chapter, that is chapter 14, to the discussion on sattva, rajas, and tamas. A while ago, I said even Adi Shankara seems to draw from Sankhya system in his commentaries to argue out certain points. In one of his bhashyas, he makes a case for Ishvara. He says, there is Ishvara. Probably it is in Kenopanita Bhashya. He says, he gives an interesting analogy. Suppose you walking through a jungle, come across a beautiful house. You say, wow, there is such a nice house here in the midst of a jungle. Let's go in. The door is open. And you go in and see that there are all facilities. There are bedrooms, there are bathrooms, there is a kitchen, there is a sitting place, everything. Nobody is in the house. Without thinking more, would you not come to a conclusion that such a well-organized, well-built house has to be for the benefit of somebody who has perhaps walked, gone for a walk, has gone somewhere? A house like this cannot come into being for its own pleasure. This sanghata, this assemblage, is for someone who is not a part of this sanghata. These ideas were actually in the Sankhya system. Prakriti's evolution, Professor Hiranna uses a very technical word in philosophy. He says the evolution of Prakriti is teleological. What is teleology? I learned this word this morning only. Teleology is a certain philosophical stand where an explanation is given. An explanation is given for a phenomenon in terms of the purpose that it serves. So you notice something and you conclude that all this is happening for a purpose. So this teleological position from a philosophical perspective was contributed by Sankhya Darshan. Now you may ask, What is the teleology here? Or in simple English, what is the purpose of Prakriti's evolution? It's a beautiful purpose. All that Prakriti is doing, you know, ups and downs, beautiful creation and very sad, painful destruction, earthquakes and floods and all that also happens in Prakriti. And new plants coming up, new life being born, etc. New children born in all species, regeneration, right? Recreation, procreation, all these are happening. So what is the purpose? The philosophy uses two words. They are well-known words in spiritual literature, bhoga and apavarga. Bhoga is these purushas need to enjoy. They are in a state of bondage. And this state of bondage has joy and sorrow. And at a learning ground. So enjoy, which also means suffer, bhoga. It is through our enjoyments and it is through our suffering that we learn and grow. We slowly get out of our aviveka and get down into viveka. Bhoga, Prakriti's evolution, is for the purpose of facilitating bhoga. Let people enjoy, let people suffer and learn. The whole idea is learning. Then comes the next stage, in fact, last stage, apavarga. Apavarga literally means escape. Finally, the soul, each purusha, according to Sankhya, each purusha one by one has to escape from this bondage in samsara. One more contribution that is given by Sankhya, which Vedanta uses, you know, to a great extent, is the utpatti, how things have come out to create this universe. Vedanta then makes some small changes, but the basic material it receives from Sankhya. One question, before one of you asks me later, I'm sure some of you would think, Vedanta takes everything from Upanishads. Why should it take from Kapila Muni's Sankhya? Please. True, Vedanta doesn't take anything from anywhere else. It takes from Upanishads. But the way I would like to express it is, this Kapila Muni, whenever he lived and created this Sankhya Darshana, he did so much of homework. He did so much of reflection on Upanishads, on the Vedas. It is from the Upanishads that he created this Sankhya Darshana. From the Upanishads, from the Vedas and so on. Therefore, when we say Adi Shankara also took from, like the teleological position, a house is meant for an owner who is not part of the house. He is not a wall or a window or a door. Likewise, in Sankhya, it is said, this whole Prakriti and its dance, its movement is for Purushas, for their liberation. So, when we say Shankara took from Sankhya Darshana, what is meant is, rather than him digging into the Upanishads for these building blocks, he used the notes of a former student. You go to study inorganic chemistry somewhere, to an extent you study the original books, and suppose you get access to some excellent notes prepared by a student of previous year, you say, this girl, my 2 year senior, has done beautiful drawings, beautiful charts, beautiful graphs. With her graphs and charts and drawings and notes, I can understand inorganic chemistry much quickly. And she is not doing any injustice to the original books or the authoritative works. Like that, Kapila Muni had done homework on the Upanishads. So coming to the Utpatti, the Srishti Prakara, Sankhya talks about Purushas being, you know, they are large number and they are over there. But as far as the Jagat is concerned, and part of the creation getting into the Purusha in the personality. You have Prakriti on top, then from Prakriti comes Mahatattva, which goes parallel to Buddhi. Then there is Ahankar, then there is Manas, the fourth item. Then 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 are the Jnanendriyas. 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 are Karmendriyas. Then 15 to 19 are Tanmatras. From those Tanmatras, there arise the grosser Bhutas, elements. And all that which you have studied in various Prakarana Granthas of Vedanta was said by Kapila Muni and later in the Sankhya Karikas by Ishvara Krishna. In the Sankhya Darshana, what things, what kind of things, just as the Tanmatras have the pure, you know, each Tanmatra has one attribute. Akasha has sound and Vayu has touch, Agni, fire has Rupam, form and so on. And then in the progression, when Akasha gives rise to Vayu, Vayu, I already said, has Sparsha, but it also has Shabda of Akasha. So Vayu is a little grosser. Agni not only has its own attribute, Guna, of Rupam, but it also has Shabda and Sparsha. Lastly, Earth has all the five attributes. So, how the subtle becomes gross with no mention of Panchikarana here in Sankhya Darshana, though that is found, as you know, in Chandogya Upanishad and then made into greater detail. Chandogya talks about Trivrit Karana, three, and these Prakarana Granthas talk about Panchikarana. So, the 24 Chaturvimshati Tattvas, another contribution of Sankhya Darshana, which Vedanta accepts. Not because it is given by Kapila Muni, but because Kapila Muni drew it from the Vedic literature. So, Sankhya is taking things from Vedas, presenting it in a certain way, and Vedanta thanks Sankhya. Oh, thank you, we needed these building blocks. So, uses them. And then we have already talked about this Ishvara, and there is no Ishvara in Sankhya. But in Yoga, there is a sutra in the very first pada. As you know, Yoga, Patanjali's Yoga Sutras have four padas. You have the Samadhi Pada, Sadhana Pada, Vibhuti Pada, and Kaivalya Pada. In the very first pada, the first chapter, have some four or five sutras, Patanjali's Yoga Sutras, and Ishvara has been called Purusha Visheshaha. There may be countless Purushas. Yoga doesn't disagree with Sankhya, but Yoga goes a step further. There is one Purusha among all these, one sentient being. He is unaffected by sorrow. He is unaffected by karma or vipaka, karma or karma phala. He is unaffected by ups and downs. He is ever free. That is called Ishvara. And Vedanta, the Yoga Shastra asks us, if we want to grow spiritually, one splendid way is Ishvara Pranidhanat, surrender to God. So God is mentioned in Yoga Shastra, not in Sankhya Shastra. All right, a few more points. There is a lot of interesting things actually. As we get to understand them, we find, wow, this gels so well with a slight difference here and there with the Vedanta, which we have been generally studying. All right. So here we have Pradhana. Prakriti is called Pradhana. Pra plus Dhana. Interestingly, you know the word Nidhi. Nidhi means treasure. Nidhi means, let's say, a box where jewelry, where pearls and diamonds are all kept. That is Nidhi. What is the etymological meaning of nidhi? Nidhi also has ni upasarga and dha dhatu. Dha means to place, to present, to keep. Pradhana. Professor Hiranyaka translates it. Pradhana means what is put before or what is presupposed. So Prakriti is put before. Prakriti presents this entire universe for us, and that is how Prakriti is sometimes called Pradhana. This came by the way. Now let's talk a little more about Purusha. This is in a way a little repetition, bear with me. Purusha, according to Sankhya Darshana, is changeless, eternal, omnipresent, and it is a bhokta without being a karta. Karta, all doing is all Prakriti's work, and Purusha suffers sukha and dukkha. That is how we have, I already quoted the 20th verse of chapter 13. There is 21 also, where Sri Krishna is, you know, those who have studied Sankhya Darshana will jump in joy. Oh, Sri Krishna has taken from our Sankhya Darshana, they will say. Purusha Prakriti Sthohi Bhunkte Prakriti Jan Gunan. Purusha Bhunkte. Purusha suffers or enjoys Prakriti's Gunas. Being seated, being caught in Prakriti. Purusha Prakriti Sthohi Bhunkte Prakriti Jan Gunan. Karanam Gunasangosya Sadasad Yoni Janmasu. Souls are reborn in good life or in some kind of undesirable bad kind of next life, all because of guna sangha. And in the same 13th chapter we have 29th verse, which says all action belongs to Prakriti. Prakriti vacha karmani kriyamanani sarvashah yap pashyati tata atmanam akartaram sapashyati. One must realize that one oneself is akarta. This is at once a mighty challenge both in Sankhya and in Vedanta. You and I, as we go through our days, again and again say, oh, I did that well, and we pat ourselves on the back. And about something else, how sad. Yesterday a funny thing happened. I was to deliver a lecture on Cisco's WebEx software, and I had provided the link to a number of people and reminded them, please remember to download the WebEx software, otherwise you won't be able to participate. I had myself forgotten to download it because I presumed that I already had it in my laptop because I had seen some programs on WebEx. Later I understood how it was a YouTube link that I had seen. Anyway, then I felt bad. I started with an apology to about 450 people who had gathered. I downloaded after the time came up. And then, of course, it took some 10 minutes or 15 minutes late. But Sankhya Darshana would tell me, Vedanta Darshana would tell me, you have no reason either to feel bad or apologetic or feel great on some other occasion. You are not the doer. Prakriti is doing everything. Prakritya eva kriyamanani karmani sarvashah. Atmanam akartaram vidhi is the Vedanta's teaching. All right. Coming to once more that design argument. The whole universe is designed for you and me. For you and me to experience things, learn lessons, move on to the higher class, and finally get liberated. This is called the design argument. Throwing some more light, Sankhya Darshana says that Prakriti's evolution is designed for Purushas to get liberated one by one. Now, commentators, recent commentators say An industry would produce, let us say, watches, wrist watches. Will it produce wrist watches unless there are people who will wear them? Only when people are ready to or they're willing to, they would be excited to use, then the company would produce watches. Like that, the Prakriti does all that it is doing for Purushas to be benefited. That is where other schools of thought say that intelligence above Prakriti should be God. But Sankhya Darshana says there's no need to introduce God here. Leave God alone, or there need not be no need for God. This is how Sankhya therefore has been rightly called atheistic doctrine. So in that context, going by that criterion, Sankhya is Nastika. But going by the criterion of whether it believes in Vedas or not, Sankhya is Astika. Please remember again and again, to decide a school of thought to be Astika or Nastika, there are two criteria. Whether Vedas are accepted or not accepted, whether God is accepted or not accepted. In fact, among the six that I have mentioned several times, Buddhism, Jainism, etc. don't figure. They are outside these six because Buddhism, Jainism, and so on, they neither accept Vedas nor do they have God in their scheme of things. So they are called Nastika, Nastika Darshana. They are Nastika in both criteria. Not to put them down, they have their own charm, their own beauty, God bless them. But in the Vedanta, we have Astika, Astika. Vedanta accepts the Vedas, Vedanta accepts Ishvara. All right. So we have Bhoga Apavarga are facilitated by Prakriti's movement. Now there comes an interesting karika. So far I haven't recited any karika for you. Let me recite a karika that is, as I told you, Ishvara Krishna in the 5th century AD wrote these 70 karikas. And he says in one of the karikas, look around. People are born at different times. People die at different times. People have their karmas which are different from person to person. Therefore, Purusha Bahutvam Siddham. 18th Karika says this. Purusha Bahutvam Siddham. Just seeing how everybody has their own baggage, the living beings or the sentient principles are many. Adi Shankara would say that is on one level, but if you go deeper, if you cut through the empirical selves, you come upon the real self. All of them are Satchidananda. I need not go more into it. Another interesting karika, 57 among the 70, talks about how Prakriti, without God, Ishwara, etc. guiding, on its own provides whatever Purushas need. A beautiful metaphor is given. A cow hasn't gone to school or college or hasn't taken a course on how I will take care of my cows when they are born. A cow, upon giving birth to a calf, just like that, will come out with the biological changes to produce milk for the sake of the calf. This is the example given by Ishvara Krishna in the 57th Karika. Vatsa vivriddhi nimittam. Vatsa, calf, vivriddhi. For the calf to get nourished and nurtured well, vatsa vivriddhi nimittam kshirasya yatha pravrittihi ajnasya. Ajna here is ignorant, reference is to the cow. The cow is ignorant. Cow doesn't have the science of being a mother and so on. But it is natural for the cow to provide kshirasya, सेम वे पुरुष विमोक्ष निमित्तम तथा प्रवृत्ति ही प्रधानस्य। प्रकृति ऑन इट्स ओन डोंट ब्रिंग ईश्वर इन टू पिक्चर सेज द कारिकाकार। वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग। सो दैट इज डिसमिस्ड। ईश्वर इज डिसमिस्ड इन द सांख्य फिलोसफी। सो वी हैव नाउ couple of important points of Sankhya Darshana now are, it is all Prakriti, no subtraction, no addition, whatever is, always is, it seems to rise or fall, but in summary, in summation, it is the same. And the effect is same as the material cause. If something has come out, don't imagine it never was. It was in its own source. So everything which was has now come into expression. These are very powerful philosophical tools for students, and going step further, they can appreciate Advaita Vedanta. And one more point is, all variety can be traced eventually to three sources, which are not, however, independent, but interdependent. The reference is to Sattva, Rajas and Tamas. Matter is characterized by perpetual motion. We already took up this issue. Even when they are in Pralaya, they are waiting to again get back to motion. And that trigger is supplied by the Purusha. And neither mind is derived from matter, nor matter is derived from the mind. So all of them are the play of Prakriti. Now a few more points. We have in the Vedanta, in fact, some of you would surely feel, as I tell you the next point, you may feel that Sankhya seems to have taken it from Vedanta. See, the next point is how this kind of Purusha and Pradhana get mixed up. The example of red hot iron ball is given. Red hot iron ball. That is, fire which has no form looks spherical, and iron which has no heat or light seems to be emitting heat and light. That's because an iron ball has been heated to become red hot. Likewise, there is a great theory of knowing, because when you talk of heat and light, especially light, that principle of knowing comes into picture. How do we know? Some of you may remember Atma Bodha. Atmanaha Sachidamshascha Buddhehe Vritti Riti Dvayam Sanyojya Cha Avivekena Janami Iti Pravartate. So, in the matter of jnana, coming to know, what is happening is the sentient dimension of Purushas and the buddhi vritti. Buddhi belongs to Prakriti. These come together. Buddhi assumes a vritti. Some of you surely have studied how there is a theory of how knowledge takes place. You see a flower, your buddhi takes a vritti of the form of the flower. Then even if you close your eyes, the flower is in your mind as the buddhi vritti. And the buddhi vritti belongs to Prakriti. The illumining principle is Purusha. That is how jnana takes place. So this is a theory of how knowledge takes place. And then let me read one more. Before that, Karika. Okay. Yes. Yes, coming closer to some concluding points. Many of you are sadhakas. You want to know finally, all this is fine, but what is the sadhana that is prescribed in Sankhya Darshana? Purusha is bound. And what is he supposed to do to get out of the bondage? It is said, like we have in Vedanta too, Sankhya Darshana maintains the position that this bondage is not real. It is through Aviveka. It is through Aviveka that there seems to be a bondage. So in the 62nd, almost close of the 70 Karikas, Ishvara Krishna writes, Tasmat na badhyate adha. Adha is an explanation, not exclamation. Exclamation. Adha. You know, look here. Na badhyate kaschit. Na muchyate. Na api samsarati kaschit. No one is bound. No one is liberated. No one is going from life to life. You say that. What are you saying? Sankhya Karika 62 has said, Sansarati Badhyate Muchyate Cha Nanashraya Prakriti. It is only Prakriti that is bound, that is doing sadhana, and then that gets liberated. But it seems in Aviveka, lack of discrimination, lack of distinguishing things, it seems that we are bound. I am very fond of that metaphor in Atma Bodha of Vedanta. The moon is not moving, the clouds are moving, and on a night sky, we get a feeling the moon is running very fast. Drishyate abhreshu dhavatsu dhavan iva yatha shashi. Just as it is the ambra, clouds that are moving, and not the moon, the Purusha has this aviveka. I lost, I won, I am dying, I am insulted, I am nowhere now, and so on. Do viveka, calm down, inquire, then you will find everything falls in place. So what is sadhana? This is also just to point out that there is no true bondage. What are we to do? 64 says, evam tatva abhyasat. You must reflect on these teachings, that this bondage doesn't belong to me. I am the witness. Evam tatva abhyasat na asmi na me na asmi na me naham iti aparishesham. Avipariyayad vishuddham kevalam utpadyate nanam. Na asmi, then nameha. There's a print mistake here. There's a dot. The dot is a print mistake. Name, nama, mama kinchidapina asti. And then I am not this personality. Naham, naham deha is implied. So atma and atma viveka. Therefore, see how close Sankhya Darshana comes to Vedanta. Only it doesn't say that the liberated one is one in all. They stick to the Bahupurushavada. The liberated one, his story is over. Other Purushas are struggling and so on. Ramana Maharshi laughs at it. He says, in dream you find a lot of people somewhere. And when you wake up, do you ask, did they also wake up? Or are they still over there where I saw all of them? When you wake up, you know that there were not many. It was you, it is you, and you alone tomorrow too. Lastly, in Jivan Mukta is described very much like Vedanta. Samyak jnanadi gamat dharmadinam akarana praptau. Dharma, adharma, all become irrelevant when samyajnana takes place. Tishtati samskara vashat. The Jivan Mukta, till his body falls, because of certain momentum of past impressions, internally he is free, but outwardly in the eyes of others he seems to be moving around. Chakra brahmavat. Like a potter, after making a pot, walks away with the pot and the wheel may rotate for some more time. Chakra Brahmavat Drita Sharira Tishtati. Name of Ishvara Krishna appears in the 70th, the last Karika, शिष्य परंपरया आगतम ईश्वर कृष्णेन च एतद् आर्याभिः, आर्या इज द मीटर, संक्षिप्तम आर्यमतिना सम्यग् विज्ञाय सिद्धांतम, सिद्धांतम संक्षिप्तम। दिस होल सिस्टम हैज बीन प्रेजेंटेड बाय ईश्वर कृष्ण। इन दिस वे एज द टाइटल वेंट फॉर दिस वेबिनार वी टुक सम ग्लिम्पसेस ऑफ सांख्य दर्शन एंड इन वन सेंटेंस वी मे हैव टू से अगेन सांख्य प्रोवाइड्स ए एक्सेलेंट फाउंडेशन which has been then used by Vedanta, and it is good, it is valuable to go to the original source where those concepts came into being. It can help in better understanding of the Vedanta Darshana. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Let's see whether some questions we have. Okay, Vijaya Prabhakar has a question. I am trying to enable her microphone. It says self-muted. Can you try to unmute your phone on your computer? It says muted by organizer also, Vijaya Prabhakar. This microphone is always a problem. Has anybody, Vijayaji, can you write down your question? There is a way to text that would be helpful. Girish Hullatti, his mic is on. Please ask Girish. Is your microphone working? Should be working. Girish Hullatti. Oh, audio is off, it says. Why? Why did it go off?
He is on phone.
Oh, he is on telephone. Okay. Let's see. How do I know the text questions dashboard? No.
To click on that question, Madhuri.
In there upstairs, Swamiji.
Ah.
If you go to this. Globe and not globe, the file. You can see there is the first thing is question. No.
Right.
There is a file. In the file, the first thing is question. I've
okay.
just put in a question.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
Oh, you have save questions log in the file. Okay. Oh, yeah, I got it. Thank you. So I will see your question. There are many who have asked questions by text. Maybe a moment. Savita. Okay, Savita Reddy has this question. Please elaborate on sensuousness of Purush and Buddhi Vritti of Prakriti. Not sensuousness, it's sentience, that is being a chetana. Yeah. Sentient. Sentient means,
yes, yes.
you know, jada or chetana.
Chetana. Yes. Chetana.
So Purusha, by correct, chetana, correct. Purusha, there is nothing to elaborate. Purusha by nature is sentient. Okay. By nature. Just as fire by nature is hot, fire by nature gives light, right? So Purusha by nature is sentient, S-E-N-T-I-E-N-T, sentient, Chetanava. And Buddhi by itself is inert, But when Purusha operates through it, it becomes sentient. Buddhi vritti. Vritti is a mode of the mind. For example, when you see with your eyes a flower and you close your eyes, your buddhi takes the shape of flower. Then we say pushpa vritti arose. Next, you open your eyes and see a pot, ghata, and close your eyes, your mind will have ghata vritti. So, by itself, like the filament in an incandescent bulb, by itself it has no light. When electricity flows through it, it gives light. Buddhi and buddhi vritti are insentient by themselves. But the Purusha sannidhi, closeness, they also give this example. You have a wall and you have a mirror on the wall. If you stand before the rest of the wall, you can't see your reflection. If you stand before the mirror, you see your reflection. Both mirror and the wall have no life. But the mirror has that ability to reflect. Just like that, buddhi has the ability to play a role for the sentient Purusha to know things. Okay, NL Sri Ram, welcome. NL Sri Ram, where did that go? Here. What would be the time frame of this school in relation to Adi Shankara's time period? That's where there's a lot of vagueness. If you take Ishvara Krishna as belonging to 5th century AD, we take generally Shankaracharya, Adi Shankara, to have appeared in the 8th century AD. So Adi Shankara came 300 years later. Kalidasa was a contemporary of Ishvara Krishna. And Kapila Muni, I would imagine, was before Christ. Maybe 1,000 years before Christ also. So Adi Shankara was 300 years later than Ishvara Krishna, who systematized the Sankhya Darshana through his Sankhya Karikas. Okay, top. Sachin Dev has 4 questions. He has hit a boundary here. You mentioned Sankhya Darshana does not accept one thing. What is that one thing? Ishvara. They don't accept God. They say there is no God, no need to propose God. There is Prakriti, there is a number of Jivatmas, Purushas. Then second, how does a Purusha get liberated if Purusha is only Bhokta? See, Bhokta means not just pleasure and pain. So Purusha in this Aviveka, lack of discrimination, feels sometimes he is winning and is happy, and sometimes he is losing and is sad. So sukha dukkha, bhokta means sukha dukkha. So how does he get liberated? By contemplating upon his true nature. This sense of enjoying or suffering is a confusion. Really nothing is happening to me. If in this way he questions and contemplates, then he realizes his true nature. So it's just aviveka, confusion. Just as I gave the example, if you closely examine and say, are the clouds moving or is the moon moving? You will find that the clouds are moving. The moon is just there. So your abhokta and akarta, will be realized. So Sankhya also, in its ultimate analysis, frees the Purusha of bhoktratva too. Sankhya plus yoga is Sankhya yoga. Yoga means joining. No, here the yoga is a word for darshana, a system of sadhana. And second chapter of Gita is called Sankhya Yoga. That again is not this Kapila Muni Sankhya. Over there, unfortunately, the word is same. When Sri Krishna's second chapter is called Sankhya Yoga, Sankhya is Vedanta only there. So depending on context, Sankhya can mean Kapila Muni's dualistic Sankhya or Dvaita Vedanta's non-dual Sankhya. What two aspects join in Sankhya Yoga? No, there is nothing joining here. It is just like I told you, yoga is a darshana, yoga is a path. The way of yoga here stands for way, not joining. Yoga is the way of Sankhya. Bhakti yoga is the way of devotion. Karma yoga is the way of selfless service. So yoga is actually, believe me, the 18 chapters of Gita are called yogas, Vishada yoga. There it is not even the way, it is topic. Arjuna Vishada yoga. First chapter is called that which has Arjuna's despair as the topic. You mentioned Vedanta Darshana has taken 90% from Sankhya. How is it that when Sankhya says Purusha only experiences there are many Purushas, Prakritis. Yeah, so those are to be eliminated. But in number, you know, in sheer number, the concepts that are taken by Vedanta are very large. But in some essential, very important area, Vedanta steps aside. So when I say 90%, it is in sheer number. Like we say in the Vedas, 90% of mantras talk about karma and upasana. That doesn't make karma and upasana the main teaching of Vedas. The 10% or 5% mantras which constitute Upanishads, they give the final teaching of the Vedas. So the 90% refers to a number of small concepts. Like somebody might have gone to a primary, elementary and high school for 10 years. But maybe his significant learning took place after that in college in 2 or 3 years. So number of years wise, he spent more time learning alphabets, adding and multiplying, etc. So in terms of the importance of teachings, Vedanta's important revelation that one truth alone is not taken from Sankhya. Does Sankhya accept Papa Punya and Karma theory? Yeah, this I missed actually. It is a major point. Sankhya very much accepts Punya and Papa and Karma theory and Samsara. It says the body is dies, but the soul meaning the Purusha, apparently goes to next life. So all those, you know, Karmendriyas, Nanendriyas, Manas, they all accompany him in the next life. Oh, you have 6 questions. According to me, Dvaita Darshana closely matches Sankhya more than Advaita. Yeah, in a sense true. But if you were to ask some Dvaiti, let's say Madhvacharya's disciple, I would not be surprised if they are more angry with Sankhya than Advaitis are. Because Sankhya does not accept Hari, Mahavishnu. See, Madhvacharya's Dvaita Darshana, Ramanujacharya's Vishishta Dvaita, they are above all very fond of and very devoted to Srimad Narayana. And Srimad Narayana has no place in Sankhya. Whereas Advaita Vedanta, which very much accepts and reveres Vishnu, Shiva and so on, in its ultimate position, talks about Nirvikara, Nirakara, Nirguna, Brahma. Therefore, in a sense, ultimately it depends on the student. In a sense, Advaita Vedantis may be somewhat at peace with Sankhya. But all the 3 Vedantas stand apart. But I do see your point. Dvaita Darshana, because they also talk of multiple souls. Sankhya also talks about multiple souls. Whether this world has been manifested because of God becomes half, one half is Prakriti, or this world has created due to our vasanas, pick anyone A or B. Okay. See, different schools of thought say differently. If you ask what does Sankhya say, you know, it is B, because there is no God in Sankhya. Your A and B. A talks about God becoming half and half. Okay. Girish has no question. Manoj Swami, Hari Om. Girish Ullatti. One can unmute by using microphone. That's a technical issue. Microphone icon. Kiran Gandhi. Is the concept of Jivatma similar to the concept of Purushas in the sense of many Purushas and many? Yeah, it's similar. But the difference is Sankhya sticks to that plurality, Advaita says that plurality goes away in deeper understanding. Shyam Sundar, you mentioned that Sankhya philosophy is the essence of both atheist and non-atheist. Will the study of Sankhya help understanding Upanishads? Yeah. Study of Sankhya does help the study of Upanishads, because as I said in my lecture also, in Jnana Yoga, we don't want to remain content with the bare skeleton. We do want details. And the details are made much clearer by study of Sankhya. Upanishadic study, Vedanta study is facilitated. If you have studied Sankhya, when you read later Shankara's commentary, you will say, I am familiar with this theory, I am familiar with this idea, I am familiar with this logic, I am familiar with this argument, you will say. Because a lot of those arguments, metaphors, and logical settings have been covered in Sankhya. It helps. Studying Sankhya helps you in yoga, study of yoga also, and perhaps Puramimamsa also. So Kiran has one more question. Does Sankhya specify on the origin of Purusha and Prakriti? Actually, it says Purusha and Prakriti have always been there, ever existent. They did not come from anywhere and they do not disappear anywhere. Purusha gets liberated, but Purusha is eternal and Prakriti also is eternal. They are self-created. They are Swayambhu in that sense. Purusha, Prakriti, both are Swayambhu. Okay, so looks like text questions are over. Now, I was looking at all text questions, and if there is any other question. Okay, Purna Rao has raised her hand, and I hope. Ah, mic also is on. Please ask. Yes, you may ask. Oh, again, it went to mute. Yeah, what is happening?
Can you hear me, Swamiji?
Yes, very well.
Okay. Swamiji, somewhere at the back of my mind, I had this thought that this Sankhya philosophy is very closely related to Buddhism. Is that right?
It will join hands, it will shake hands with many philosophies. Yeah. But you know, in Buddhism, I don't think they talk so much about Prakriti, Purusha, etc. Their whole approach is a little different. There will be some common ground, but this idea of the sentient being caught in gunas perhaps is not the language of Buddhism. In Buddhism, they talk about defilements. Our mind is defiled. Defiled means a kind of impurity. So we must meditate. We must walk the eightfold path. And we must cleanse our mind. We must allow the water of the pond to settle down. The dust should settle down and the water should be serene. They have a different bunch of models. They do not talk about this aviveka and so on. Otherwise, Sankhya, why not? Sankhya definitely has much common ground with Buddhism too, because both talk about liberation, both talk about in ignorance we are attached to a lot of things. In wisdom, we become liberated. So that way. Let's have a session on Buddhism sometime. We'll examine.
Thank you. Thank
because
you,
under
sir.
Indian all of these come. But I would like to take a session on Patanjali's yoga very soon. So we'll see. Then it will strengthen our Sankhya understanding also. And together it will pave the way to better grasp of Vedanta. That's about it, I think. Thank you all. We'll meet again in 2 weeks. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Shri Kapila Munaye Namaha.
Pranam Swamiji.
Hari Om.